Hello. My name is Jan Lauren Greenfields. Welcome. So Pratt has always been a sanctuary to artists, to thinkers, a place to experiment, to fail, to take risks, and to collaborate. It seems like the perfect place to sort of host our three-week series, Collaboration, Business, Art, and Activism. And tonight, we have a special kickoff event, Art as Activism. So welcome. How many of you all are students? Can you just raise your hands? Okay, great. How many of you are artists? Cool. And activists? Okay, awesome. Yes. So collaboration is a creative process. It crosses all industries, and it always leads, well, when done well, it leaves one with a sum greater than its parts. As you'll hear over the next 3 weeks, regardless of the path you take, collaboration and coalition building are critical to success in any endeavor. Next week, we'll discuss business and technology with one of the co-founders of Behance, which was acquired by Adobe, and we'll explore effective transition management, and it's a great session for entrepreneurs and those interested in tech and startup. The third session in this series, we will look at a more intimate look in collaboration. We'll have writer and director Jay Dunn and Dave Bob, who are working on a feature film together as a writing team, so we'll look at the collaboration in like a intimate art process. And those sessions will take place at the Center for Career and Professional Development office. Tonight, as I mentioned, we've got this special event. It's our kickoff event, and we're going to explore the intersection of art and activism. How can we apply what these incredible panelists have learned to the vision that we have collectively and individually for our world? What can you guys take from what they have accomplished, what they've learned, what they failed at, and make use of it tomorrow? So with that, I'm gonna turn it over to our moderator for the evening, Kirsten Reichart. Kirsten is an innovation catalyst. Her firm, Reichart Innovation Consulting, works with corporation and nonprofits to spark positive change. Throughout her career, Kirsten has been fascinated by the use of art to move communities towards new possibilities. Without Kirsten, these panelists, none of this would be here tonight. So please put your hands together, welcoming her and our panelists. Thank you.
Thank you, Jan. I'm going to start by having us meet the panelists. Molly Gotchman is an experiential artist and activist. She is the creator of the Red Sand Project, an activist artwork created to raise awareness of human trafficking and modern-day slavery. Chandri Barat is the executive director of the Barat Foundation, an arts education organization dedicated to the power of the arts to transform lives and communities and level the playing field for underserved youth. Ismilda Abreu is the AVP of Student Affairs here at Pratt, and the co-founder of Real Beauty Uncovered, a movement that uses photography to promote media literacy and body image acceptance. And Orville Morales is a community outreach specialist who serves the US Congressman Bill Pascrell Jr. in District 9 in New Jersey, and he is an expert in engaging diverse communities and collaborating with community organizations. So that's our esteemed panel. I would like to start by introducing some key concepts about art and activism that I've found when working with programs so that they are really successful. So I'm just gonna share sort of a couple of key concepts and get us started, and then we'll be using those concepts as we go. So what is arts activism? A definition that we can use commonly today is arts activism is a strategy for fostering social engagement and volunteerism by connecting public art platforms to social justice initiatives. And it's been really a powerful tool for promoting change. And art activism projects bring three major spheres together: the arts, the social issues, and community. And at that sort of intersection of those three fields, that's when a successful art activism project really, you have an opportunity for that. So let's just sort of start with the basics. I saw a lot of you were raising your hands with artists and maybe not so much about activism. So why is it so effective to use the arts to advocate for change? I sort of distilled three key principles when you talk to organizations like the ones that that our panelists represent. Art is really engaging. It's attracting attention, and it also can be moving, even in very brief experiences. Art can make it really safe for people to talk about what are very difficult issues, and to really sort of learn about social justice topics. And art also provides a prompt. So it provides some stimulus that allows for a subsequent community discussion about an issue, and it can really lead to commitments to change going forward. So that's kind of some three key principles. And sort of what are some key tips for creating a successful project? Three key tips, and our folks will talk a little bit more about this, is really you need to select an issue that's really important to the community that you're trying to engage. You also need to ensure that you're treating that in a way that is respectful and makes sense, and you do that by partnering with community and expert thought leaders. And then one way that I've seen organizations really take advantage of a project is to go deeper by facilitating a community forum where people share their experiences of interacting with the art, and then really have that be a forum where you can encourage them to take action and to commit to action going forward on the issue. So three key steps: engage, present, and share. First, each of these groups that we're talking about here is really having the public or the viewing audience actually engage in the artistic experience. There is an opportunity to present the art within the community, and actually this is sort of different aspects. That could be a parade. It could be an art exhibit that's happening at a local school. It could be a formal art exhibit or even an online exhibit. And then, really, part of it is sharing the insights that are generated out of viewing or participating in the art in a public forum where you're asking questions that have people reflect on what they saw and then actually drill in and go deeper. And these are just pictures. Actually, the photos in all of these were taken from all three of these projects. So that's an example of the reflection questions, an example of the public forum, and then also posting it online and continuing the dialogue by having it have an online presence where people can participate and update and share what they've done next is very cool. So that was a lot of talking. So now I'm going to pause, because really, this public forum is about creating a community around the issue. So we are going to take a moment. Molly is going to guide us, because we are actually a community. And so she's going to have us create community out of art.
So I see that some of you are already playing with your string. That's great. You're making it unique. All of us are unique people. And I want everyone to... you're starting a new school year, build, bring this community even closer. So find someone to your left, to your right, in front of you, behind you, and tie your string to that person's string. And you can interpret this however you want. I'm thinking about this as, you know, us being these unique beings, but fragmented, and how can we become stronger and become a tighter knit community, more networked. So thank you.
I see y'all are still trying to reach across the aisles back there. That's cool. So this is a quick exercise in how engaging a community in creating art together is really activating lots of different things for the community. And it's kind of modeling what our panelists have done in their work. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask each of the panelists to introduce themselves and to take a few moments to share what they are doing in this field. So we're going to start with you, Molly. And so tell us about your work and how it uses art to activate change.
Thank you. So I was working as an artist for years, and I took some time off and read an article about modern-day slavery and was appalled by the scale of it and even more upset and shocked that I didn't know it was going on to this magnitude. And so I reached out to different organizations to learn what I could do. And every organization I reached out to said, help raise awareness. So I was a real bummer at cocktail parties because I would start conversations about human trafficking. And then the issue was also, well, how do you bring this issue to new audiences? So how do you take something that everyone told me was hiding in plain sight and take the subject onto the streets and connect with strangers? Like, you guys just connected with strangers tonight. So how do you do that? Because there's always an awkwardness to that. So I felt like, you know, this issue, there was such an enormity of it. People debate the numbers, but whether it's 28 million, 36 million, or 45 million who are enslaved today, it's a lot of people. And so you feel overwhelmed and like there's nothing that you can do. But these small grains of sand, they build upon each other and they transform the sidewalk crack. And so it's asking people to be mindful of the vulnerabilities that exist all around us. So the sidewalk cracks are a metaphor for the vulnerabilities that exist in all of our communities. And so these are different images of what the red sand looks like in the sidewalk cracks. And as you're out there doing it, you are making yourself vulnerable, not in a heavy way, but you do feel a little silly, but it starts the conversation. So how do you start that conversation? And then how do you expand the conversation to a broader audience? So that's where hashtagging Red Sand Project, trying to build a movement to address the vulnerabilities that lead to modern day slavery. And so I beg people to hashtag Red Sand Project when they share their image so that we can build this community. And then we can start to inform them of, hey, there's going to be an activation in your community, or there's a policy that change that we need to advocate for as a community. So that's part of why it helps to create a network and expand that network. I think that the project itself is most successful when people make it their own. This was done in Oakland, California, and it was different women who had been trafficked or who were close to the situation or just saw what was going on in their community, and so they created rituals that were inspired by Red Sand Project. They did call and response. They had dances going on around the Lake Merritt, and it was so powerful and so beautiful, and it's because it came from their genuine experience and their genuine stories, and so I think the strength of the project, this participatory project, is that people make it their own. That's an image of one of the dance performances. And then this is an image I a few years ago wanted to, or a couple years ago, raise awareness about discrimination as a vulnerability that leads to exploitation. So this is a land art installation in the shape of the border between the US and Mexico. And I invited members of the community to fill it with red sand. So the idea is that discrimination is a vulnerability that leads to exploitation. And so it does kind of look like a crack when you see it from above. I don't think I have that picture here. But it is about us coming together, building this community, and transforming. So thank you.
Next, Chandri, do you want me to go straight to the, do you want me to come up or do
you? You know what, I'll play this and then you can come up or stay where you are.
I, Nasir King.
I, Erica Mejia.
I, Burnett Curtis Grayson.
Kevin Lopez.
Janelle Colon.
Ashley Masu.
I, Javina Santiago.
I, Isabella Suarez.
I, Daniel Mendez.
I, Rowena Nitima.
I, Devin D'Amico.
I, Christian Beljour.
Do solemnly pledge, do my best to promote peace within myself.
I hereby dedicate myself to promote nonviolence,
the furtherance of human rights, spiritual values,
and the inherent dignity of all human beings.
Well, I think this peace mural is incredible for the city of Newark because it represents the collective spirit of our community, not only the physical contributions of individuals, but it's really a powerful pledge that we're all making to support our children, to protect our children, to elevate our city, and to protect our future.
We're coming together for a celebration!
We're coming together for a celebration!
The power of creation.
All the people are demonstrating.
The power of a creation nation.
Okay, so first I really want to thank Esmilda and Kirsten for inviting us here. It's a real honor to be here at Pratt. We are the Barat Foundation, Creation Nation. We are a public art education organization. We're based in Newark. Everything we do is with the public. We do murals as this one. This mural was painted in honor of the Dalai Lama and International Peace Summit coming to Newark. It was painted by over 500 children in 14 schools. And that's what we do. We're known for a new art form that we developed, a new urban art form called animodules. These are three-dimensional sculpture-type figures that represent the communities that they come from. When we talk about public art by the public in a city like Newark, we want to make sure that the children of the city and the people of the city are included in the cultural landscape of the city. If you walk around most cities, and certainly Newark, and you look at the public art, particularly sculpture, to be honest, it's a bunch of dead white guys. And that's beautiful, it's wonderful, we want to honor our history, but it doesn't look like the people that live in the city, and it doesn't reflect the exuberance and the hopes and the dreams of the city, and in particular, the children of the city. We recently finished a large project in honor of Newark's 350th anniversary, and we created 5 animodule sculptures that were thematic. One was diversity immigration, one was business, one was urban changes, one was education. And these pieces were created by the kids. It was an interdisciplinary program where we went in the schools, we worked with history teachers, we worked with creative writing programs, and asked the people of the city, in particular the children of the city, and this project also involved senior citizens, how they wanted to represent their history. What we don't want to do is go into a place and say, I have a great idea for you, and you're going to like it or not. What we want to do is get the ideas from the community. And we do this in many ways. We call our first phase an ideation phase, when the students or the seniors or the community gets together to discuss how they want to represent themselves, their community, on this artwork. And then we bring in very talented, very gifted, very patient artists, teaching artists, artists in residence, who work with those thoughts and try to organize them visually into something beautiful. And then at the final phase, the community, the students, the children, the seniors actually paint the final pieces. And right now in Newark, there are about 50 of these animodule sculptures. They're all over the city. They're also at the Newark Airport, where they greet 500,000 visitors to the city each year. And their energy and their beauty is the energy and the hopes and the dreams of the kids that have created them. When we go into a classroom, I was just mentioning we went into a classroom in the Ironbound section of Newark. There were 28 students in the 6th grade class, and when I asked them, how many of you speak another language at home, 25 of these children raised their hands. And so this particular class, we involved on the diversity animodule piece that we did. And each of these kids painted images of the countries they came from, Brazil, Ecuador, and those images were then organized onto the piece. So each of these sculptures that we create, the murals that we create, are created with the ideas and the hands and the hearts of the community. And this we call public art by the public. And it's amazing how talented these young people are. And we're talking about young people, 80% of whom qualify for free or reduced price lunch. We're talking about children that live at or below the poverty line, some of them 200% below the poverty line. These children are told from the time they're 7 years old that they're 3 years behind in reading and they're 2 years behind in math, which becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. By the time they're 10, they're failures. What we do is we go in to the 7-year-old, the 10-year-old, the 12-year-old, the 14-year-old, and we find what they're really good at. And then the child can become as addicted to success as he or she was previously addicted to failure. And so that's what we mean by public art by the public. We say there you can be 3 things. You can be a consumer, you can be a critic, or you can be a creator. And in terms of empowering individuals and communities, we found that being a creator is the way to empowerment. Thank you.
Now Esmelda's going to share the Real Beauty Uncovered Body Image Media Literacy Program.
I wanna leave. had meant something that I left behind. When I leave this world, I'll leave no regrets. Leave something to remember so they won't forget I was here.
Talk a little bit about Real Beauty Uncovered. I'm not an artist. I'm part of a three-part co-creation with Danny Allen, who is our photographer, and Madeline Thompson, who is our psychologist and counselor that does earth-based eco-feminist empowerment. I am a scholar activist. I teach business and I teach women and gender studies. And one of the things that we found out was that since 1970, eating disorders have gone up 400%. 400%. 90% of women in the United States feel uncomfortable with their bodies, apologetic, feeling like they're not worth it. 80% of 10-year-olds have already started to diet. And 80% of those same 10-year-olds are terrified of being fat, more than being homeless, more than not succeeding in school. What is it? What's the media doing differently today than in 1970? Where are these numbers coming from? And so we started talking about beauty politics in a way that made it personal. Because the commodification of women and girls is constructed daily. It's the buying and selling of certain images, certain services, and certain assumptions that are being put out there every minute of the day. So much so that we're told that were interchangeable. And guess what? Only 5% of the American female bodies represent what we see in magazines. Why is that? Why is our real selves not enough? So Real Beauty Uncovered was our attempt to be able to talk about the issue, bring it to light, uncover. And not only uncover it in terms of what's happening out there in the world, that people are not to be purchased, as in human trafficking, that we don't have to apologize for who we are, that we can fully contribute. These were the things that impassioned us. So we started this photography program, and we invited students, mostly, to step on up. And as we interviewed them about what character would they be in a book? When do they feel strong? Is beauty the same thing as attractiveness? When did they know that they were going to make it in the world? Did they ever have a doubt about their ability to make a change? And as they spoke about their passion, their fears, their identity, their bodies, they would say the most brilliant things. And they would say the most compassionate things. And here's the thing about neuropsychology. What we say, we hear. What we say, we hear. And what we say, when we hear it, turns into a biochemical reality in our body. It empowers us. It changes us. And what we saw was that after this interview process, people were changing. and they were asking themselves powerful, powerful questions. So we've done this now for about 3 years. We have a huge community of models, right? And our models come together in a reveal. As they're doing these questions, the photographer's taking the pictures, they don't know which moment was captured in that hour of conversation. What you saw today was that moment, that snapshot, and whatever quote was being captured that lit them up, that made them feel authentic. Real Beauty Uncovered is an awareness project for media literacy. It has 4 levels of awareness. The first one is to recognize that we're being told what to be, to reject that is not true about us. So that would be the second thing, right? So first to recognize, then to reject, then to reclaim, I am funny, or I am powerful, or look at that, I'm kind of cute, right? Whatever it is about us that we can claim. And then finally, in this art exhibit, we reveal the photos to the models. And for the very first time, they see themselves. And they see themselves in a black and white photo with no makeup, just a black t-shirt, and, you know, black clothes. The artwork is not put behind glass. It's completely uncovered, rare, raw, and honest, right? We want it to be as authentic as they are. And what's really fascinating is that as they're walking around the room looking at their photo, they see themselves as beautiful. And they don't know who they're going to be next to. So Miss New Jersey was one of our models, right? It's a gorgeous woman, always had a lot of issues around her hair and her complexion. She felt always not enough. And Miss New Jersey was next to a mom that had something like 100 and something tattoos on her body because she hid behind her tattoos and never felt fully herself until she embraced other identities. And that person was next to another person who had 20 surgeries after a car accident, and that person was next to another person who was 102 years old. And each one of them was so beautiful, and they saw each other, and they recognized that in this community of women, they were really seen. And there was something really amazing about that. Many, many, many of our models went on to do activism. Here's what was also interesting. As our models came with their friends, their families, sons, fathers, friends started saying, can we do the interview too? And now we'll be doing a continuum of Real Beauty Uncovered. If you want to see some of the photos, they're here in the Center for Equity and Inclusion over in the main building. We have a little small display. And if you're ever interested in becoming one of our models and getting involved in our community of reflection and awareness, we're always looking. So that's a little bit about the project.
So those were each of the art projects that we're featuring. Orville, do you want to just say a quick word about who you are and what you bring to the table for art and activism?
Sure, thank you. Should I go on?
There or there, whichever you
Hello, everyone. Hello, everyone. My name is Orville Morales. I am a program director for Congressman Pascrell in New Jersey. Anyone from New Jersey? Thank you, I'm not alone entirely. So what I do is I am essentially the bridge between the government and its people in the 9th Congressional District. Oftentimes, and it's very a popular sentiment, our elected officials are not connected with its people. They're siloed in Washington, and I work for someone who goes to Washington every week. He just went to Washington yesterday. However, every office has someone, well, I can't say like myself because I'm pretty good at what I do, that is extremely conscientious of the fact that our government needs to listen to our communities. And my role is to make sure that any community, from students, business owners, veterans, individuals in transportation, carpenters, laborers, undocumented individuals, immigrants, a plethora of individuals, ensuring that their representative is listening to them. And one of the reasons why I was brought here is because one of my biggest passions, my career, has been around civic engagement. I advocate for individuals to be involved in their communities through government. And a lot of the different activities that you heard of today fall in the category of advocacy. They're passionate about an issue. They're passionate about human trafficking. They're passionate about our inner beauty. They're passionate about encouraging our students to grow. And I advocate for individuals to be aware of what our communities need. So in a little while, I'll talk a little bit more about how you can engage with the community that's important to you.
Okay, great. Now we're gonna open it up, and I have some questions for each of the presenters. And then also, if you have questions, we can take questions from the community at the end. So Molly, as you said, human trafficking can be a really difficult and sensitive subject. So when you were thinking about the best way to kind of be able to explain the issue, how did you kind of refine the issue in your mind for yourself, and how did you link it to the particular form of art that you wound up using in your project?
Well, it is a sensitive issue, and I think a lot of the work being done showed images of trafficking victims or survivors. So I was thinking, well, how can I create an image that doesn't exploit a victim or a survivor? And so it was thinking about the vulnerabilities, like what led someone to be in the situation that they were in. And so taking the attention into on a public space, so using the sidewalk cracks is what helped me do that.
Great. When people in this audience think about doing sort of art and activism kinds of projects, how do you recommend that they kind of refine the issue, and how do you recommend that they think about what form of art might pair with it?
Well, I think like Chandri was saying, with having it be informed by people who are closer to the issue. So talking to, whether it's trafficking survivors or people who are social workers who work with trafficking survivors regularly, and learn from them first. So I think sometimes we can assume we know a way to address an issue, but if we're not being informed by those closest to it, we might accidentally make a mistake in how we're conveying our sympathy or empathy.
Okay. Okay, so Chandri, you have chosen to engage the public in producing the art. So you shared with us that the tagline is public art by the public. Why do you think it's so important to have people participate in the act of making the art themselves? Like, why is that important to the activism part of a project?
It's all about civic engagement. The population, the communities we work with are disengaged, as many of us are from the political system and what have you. So how do we bring them into the center, you know, into the eye of the storm? And when we say the cultural landscape, when you look around cities, and, you know, now that there are beautiful murals, you know, appearing all over the country, these murals speak more directly to the population, the people that are now living. We're history too. And so when we say public art by the public, that mural that we saw, that mural was done, it was Mayor Cory Booker, now he's a US Senator. That was 6 years ago. There is graffiti to the left of that mural. There is graffiti to the right of that mural. That mural will never be touched because everyone knows that it came from the community. And if we want our young people to be engaged, we have to create vehicles for them to be engaged. And art is such a common denominator. Often when we go into a school, the teacher will say, watch out for Muhammad, watch out for Zaki, they're problems, they're troublemakers. And after 2 weeks, we'll find out that Muhammad and Zaki come up with the most creative ideas. And so it's this encouraging the creative in young people, and our last project was in seniors as well. And then imagine, you know, that you can see this piece of art out in public that you created. Behind me is the Creation Nation Art and Peace Parade. So the animaturals I was describing to you, there are about 50 or so of them now around Newark, come together, we put them on wheels like skateboards, and we parade them through the city. And if the children of our city aren't yet ready to go to the Newark Museum or spend much time in a white wall gallery, then gosh darn it, we're gonna bring that art out onto the streets where they can see it, where they can be part of it. And our art is not a spectator sport. The parade is not a spectator parade. The parade is hundreds and hundreds of kids and teachers and musicians and artists coming together to celebrate diversity, art, and peace.
Great. So just to, speaking to that, all the people and all the different organizations and all the different groups that were involved in it, collaboration, which is the sort of key theme, one of the key themes of our series, is really a core part of that. So, when you're thinking about sort of what Jan was talking about, like the do this and hey, don't do that, what are some sort of key things that people who are considering art activism kinds of projects should think about when they think about collaborations that will work?
Keep trying. We are compulsive collaborators. We've worked with our local ShopRite. ShopRite came into Newark and came to us and had this idea about a community mural. And so, same thing, 11 schools, 300 kids painted the community mural that's up in ShopRite. PSEG, which is a very conservative organization, was one of the major sponsors of the Newark 350 Animodule Project. So you don't know where you can turn a stone. You might have some pre-ideas about who's going to work with me and who's not going to work with me. We went to a local engineering architecture firm, Pannoni, and they kicked in something for the parade. We went into the Thomas Edison Foundation. They kicked something in for the parade. The Dodge Foundation, the Newark Public Schools, the Office of the Mayor. When we do these videos, the credits, I cut them off because they go on and on and on. Because that's what it is. We're trying to galvanize a community. And in our case, this community is the city of Newark. And so we'll go to the political, we'll go to the social, we'll go to the business. We'll go wherever we can go to get support for what we're doing. And sometimes you're really successful, sometimes you're not. And you just have to really keep trying.
So, Ismilda, thinking about the Real Beauty Uncovered project, we sort of started by laying out some kind of three steps and sort of engage, display, and share. And so I know Real Beauty Uncovered really focuses on that sharing aspect. So can you describe one of the reveal activities that's a culminating activity for the project and explain how it works and why it's an important part of the project?
Okay, so we do the project in local high schools, obviously colleges and universities, community groups. And for example, in Paterson, New Jersey, which is an area with tremendous need, we went in and did this project with an entire eighth grade class, right, boys and girls. We looked at delivering the message that Real Beauty is all about, which is just be you, you're enough, you're whole, perfect, and complete, just the way you are, these very basic messages. What's interesting about the process of coming together and then seeing one another in this reveal, in this time, this culminating activity, is that it's a moment to stop and really see, right? Because oftentimes we're looking, but do we really see one another? And to guide those students to appreciate what they see in themselves and in others, to see themselves as a community and go around the gallery, it's very, very, very powerful. So what we find is there's that stopping, that pausing is very important, the sharing of the experience, the testimonials of why, you know, they were surprised about maybe the quote that was selected or how they felt about being seen. All of these kind of conversations begin to trigger different ways of knowing oneself. And what we've noticed is in that pausing and in that reflection, even in the waiting between taking the picture and the day of the reveal, there's a lot of thinking and processing that goes on, a lot of sharing and thinking and talking and then surprise that creates an opportunity to know oneself. So the reflection creates the learning, right? So it's not what happens, it's how you reflect on what happens that creates your reality. And so what we've noticed is in the sharing, people stop, reflect, reclaim what they want, and then share that new identity with one another. And we noticed tremendous power in that. The other thing was, it was framed under acceptance and compassion, and this understanding that we are whole and complete, perfect. And we don't have to do any more than that. We can't mess it up. We can't.
So if folks are thinking about doing their own art and activism project, what are some things to think about when doing kind of a reveal or a sharing or a public forum that you feel like are sort of key things to think about as an organizer?
Okay, so we presented this same panel for the White House in an interfaith community that engaged thousands and thousands of people. And the most interested group was the Department of Defense. I said, wait a minute, why is the Department of Defense interested in an art and activism conversation from some scholar activists and some artists? What's going on? And what they said was, when there's time of distress, when there is war, when there's distrust, when there's separation, when there's no hope, art speaks. Art speaks like nothing else can speak. Art allows us to engage both our mind and our emotions. And then the technique of creating mutual experiences, a shared experience, not only in the creation, but also in the reflection, and then in the celebration. So many, many different steps in that process of engagement. You're engaging while you're making the art. You're engaging yourself, your and others in the reflection. And then finally, you're sharing and you're transforming, right? So you can use those three steps to do many, many things. After the Orlando shooting, we were able to take an animal module, a beautiful swan, put it in the middle of a labyrinth, gather up about 40, 50 interfaith community members, and have an opportunity to create an experience through art, sound, and music, and then share what we've learned, create an intention for those that were lost, create a new intention for those that remained, and create another intention for ourselves personally in a society that we want to live in. And what we found was that pausing, that intentionality, and then the sharing of the experience created a very, very powerful community. That group still meets, and they're doing activism in their town. It's very, very powerful. So art, like Kirsten says, is a trigger. It prompts action. It causes us to speak to one another and identify the issue, and then it causes us to see one another. And once we see one another, well, we're gonna engage. And once we engage, we demand. And once we demand, we make a change. And so it's a very powerful formula. It can be used in many, many different types of medium, communities, for different issues. And if anybody here is ever interested, again, I'm here in the Student Affairs Office, so more than happy to assist in creating change and assisting in art and activism right here at Pratt.
Great. And teeing up that, Orville, in many ways, the most critical element of this kind of project is in engaging the community. So what are some best practices that we should think about in terms of engaging the community in a project like this?
So as you can see up here, and I'll talk a little bit about these three ways to engage the community, it's certainly important for you to identify that community, and we alluded to that earlier, you know, identifying what your issue is and who could certainly benefit from engaging around that issue. So assuming that either one, you have that issue in mind and you're ready to engage other individuals, or you don't have an issue in mind, but if you're here today, something tells me you're passionate about something, even if you haven't defined it exactly. So this applies to both groups, whether you define that issue or not. Bless you. Number one, realizing that there are community leaders that are engaged in various communities, different issues. As I mentioned before, I've seen leaders in one community versus leaders in another community. They say community really is defined on what you're passionate about. And when you identify that, or even if you're passionate about an aspect, ask a question and find them and let them know about what you're working on and what you're interested in. With that, I want to give a quick shout out to Jan Greenfield, because she came back to the community that educated her in Pratt to engage in things that she experienced throughout her life, so that way she can engage all of you. So she's a perfect example, and let's give her a round of applause for that. Because it's important to remember where you're from and what inspired you to be passionate about what you are today, and connecting with those leaders. As Milda is another individual that is right here in your community in Pratt that you can reach out to. Make sure you get their numbers and connect with them. And of course, it expands to other individuals, business owners, and members of churches and synagogues and mosques, individuals of different ethnic communities. Because the leaders there are connected with an expansive community that you aren't connected to. And if you believe that the issue you're striving for affects them, it's important that you connect with them. Number two, and this may seem a little bit obvious, but just putting an art piece on the wall and hoping someone walk by is not as effective if you tell somebody about it. And reaching out to different individuals and telling them, hey, listen, check this out. Certainly the work that Molly and Chandri are doing, they can't just put sand on the floor or just get two kids and expect things to change. They had to reach out to individuals in the community and promote their work, whether it's in person, literally walking them to their project and helping them engage, or using social media and all of the tools that we have to our advantage. And of course, don't just stop at the event. Don't stop at the activity. Don't stop because today we had a great turnout right now, doesn't mean that we shouldn't continue engaging. Again, I have to go back and give a shout out to Jen Greenfield, because this is only part one of this conversation. So again, she's using a great example of coming back and continuing the conversation with some sort of follow-up, ensuring that people can see it on your website, people can engage with it through video, people can engage with it because, again, there's another event. Those three tools are extremely important, whether you have something in mind that you want to engage with, or you're curious and you want to learn more, just show up. Talk to people who are engaged in different issues. You know, help them promote their activity if you're not sure what you're going to advocate for, because that helps too. It helps somebody. So promote someone else's work. Case in point, I just did that. I promoted other people's work because I don't do what they do. I don't engage in their work, but they do amazing work. So promote theirs. And again, finally, keep talking about it. Let people know that I'm going to let people know that I saw these great programs. They should check it out. Look at the website.
Did you want
to
do?
Oh, yeah, that too. Oh, sorry. So it's really reiterating some three important things, and I actually narrow these down to some three basic concepts. Number one, eyeballs to eyeballs. I know some of you might check the websites that you're going to see later, but right now we're here. If you have a question, can you see my eyeballs? It's a literal eyeball to eyeball connection. Because nothing's more powerful than connecting with somebody face-to-face. Social media is great. We get a lot of eyes to look at our images and our videos and our statements and our work. But the real connection, we're human beings, and we can only truly connect when we're looking at each other, uncovered, the real versions of ourselves. So remember, eyeballs to eyeballs is just the best way to connect and to advocate for your issue. Provide context to your audience. If your audience don't understand why you're doing it, they're gonna have a hard time connecting with it. Each one of these individuals gave you some great context of why they do what they do. It's important that you do the same thing. Don't assume that someone understands your art piece, that someone understands what you're advocating for. Sometimes people have, I'll give you an example. I've never seen red sand being put into cracks. It actually inspired some things in my own mind, but I've never seen it before if I didn't engage. And to give you an example of getting context, if I didn't have a mentorship relationship with Ismilda right here, I wouldn't be here today 10 years later. And that gives you further context of why it is that we advocate what we do, and you need to do the same thing for the audience that you're trying to inspire. And finally, always follow up. Always follow up. How many times have you said hello to somebody, you met them, have a great conversation, you exchanged numbers, and you never called each other again? Has anybody had that experience before? And I'm not speaking in the romantic sense. Personal, I won't cross that bridge. But oftentimes, some amazing things could have happened if someone called. Just say, hey, I was thinking of you. Hey, remember that conversation we had about that project? Well, I just started something. You want to help? Does it mean that they're always going to jump on board? No. But if you don't follow up, they're never going to get on board. So always follow up when you're engaging with the community, because sometimes they can be busy. There's been plenty of times that Ismilda has been busy, and she couldn't get back to me immediately, so I called her again, and we're closer than we've ever been. But because we follow up. I'm still upset about that, by the way. No, I'm kidding. That final thing is always follow up. Try to stay in touch. If you get any of our emails or cards at the end of this and you reach out to us once, do it again. It's all right. Follow up. If at the third, fourth time, we understand, okay, we just gave you a hint. I don't think this group is that kind of group. But remember, always follow up.
So now I'm going to ask some general questions, and any of you panelists can jump in and sort of take it on. So the first question is, looking back on the work that you've done so far, can you share a story about when you felt your project really contributed to transformation, when it was really successfully advocating and activating change?
I'll jump in. There was a student who had never dared to have her natural hair. She was an African-American student, always covered her hair or straightened her hair. And at the day of the reveal, she had felt so empowered that for the first time in her 20 plus years, she felt comfortable being herself and showing the world who she really was and her hair. And what was also interesting was that it had financial implications for her because there was a cost, right, to trying to conform. And so she noticed that she had better things to do with her funds than apologize for the texture of her hair and who she was, hide. And instead, she said, I have better things to do with this money. And she just thanked the project for allowing her to stop and think about her type of beauty, her form of beauty. It was really, really powerful for me to hear and to see that student come alive. It was just beautiful.
We usually work with young people, but a project we did last year, as I mentioned, we worked with seniors as well. And as I said, we go through an ideation phase where we ask the community. In this case, we worked with three senior centers in the city to tell us how they want to be represented. And in one case, we were working with a senior center in the Central Ward of Newark, and they were working on these animodules with thematic, and the one that they were working on was diversity and immigration, and this was a totally African-American group, and they were working on the Great Migration. For those of you who don't know, millions of African Americans migrated from the South to the North between about 1920 and 1960. It was the largest migration in the history of the United States. And ironically enough, this was their story. Every one of these people had done that migration. And we had an African-American artist who was the artist in residence, and he put in, they wanted a train, and they wanted people in cars, and the seniors described the scenes that they wanted, that they had experienced, and the artist kind of tries to put it into some kind of visual cohesive form, and did. And at the unveiling of the animodules, the seniors were there. And when their animodule, the diversity immigration animodule, we had them covered in brown paper, and it was a big ta-da and in a big plaza in the city. When we unveiled that animodule, those seniors cried that they had their story in a permanent fixture that spoke to their history and the history of their city. And everyone cried. It was really an amazing moment. These artworks, they're artworks, but they're much more than that. They reach a spiritual level. The animodule behind me, we call them the totem, that was created by young men who had been incarcerated, who were in a drug recovery program. And when we started working with this group, these, talk about disengaged, these kids were lying on the floor. They could care less. They weren't going to do anything. And one day passed, and 2 days passed, and by the third day, one or two of them, because the artist was so fabulous, one or two of them started getting involved. And by the end, they were all involved, and they were all part of this permanent piece that that is at Integrity House. So creating something that has a permanent position in a group, with when we're talking about this shared experience and the reflection, and then being seen and recognized in public Everyone wants to be acknowledged. I don't care if you're a recovering drug addict, I don't care if you're a gang member, I don't care who you are, everyone wants to be acknowledged. And if we can create these vehicles for some of our underserved people to be acknowledged in public, then we've done a great service.
So the second question is, what is one recommendation or piece of advice that you would give folks who are considering doing their own art and activism? One piece of advice.
I'd say don't give up. Sometimes you might have what you feel is a great idea and you're surrounded by people who might not agree with you. Don't let it go. There's someone out there that could really connect with it. And thankfully, at least for us, we live in a region that there's a lot of people, a lot of diverse individuals. As long as you're waiting to continue talking about it, connecting with it, engaging, growing with it, you'll find 1, 2, 3, 5, 10, 20 individuals that will join you. And to really emphasize that, when you look at the group of individuals that are here, we seem like we're one individual per organization, per issue. If we didn't speak up, if we didn't continue pushing, we wouldn't have found other people that become our advocates for that issue, that help us out to continue exposing us to other individuals. If I gave up, Esmilda would not have positioned me to do this multiple times and encouraged me to continue. So don't give up. Don't feel that you're alone. It's just that you haven't met them yet, if you feel that way now.
I'm going to say make meaning, right? Because symbols have power. Concepts have power. Once upon a time, there was no such thing called child labor. People had children to work them, right? By the age of 3, American children knew how to knit their own socks. They were grabbing, you know, rocks and taking it back and forth on the farm. They were doing work, and they were meant to be worked. Child labor is a concept that came from an idea, a person's sense of empathy, compassion, change, desire for change. And they took that concept and they talked about it and they promoted it and they framed it and they repeated it and they justified it. And now we know you don't do that in a 3-year-old, right? Right? There's a reason that the world has changed, because we have this concept. One symbol can represent a concept that creates change. I happen to know that everybody here at Pratt is a change maker. We're creators. We sit on things that are getting designed, we wear things that are being designed, and we shape thought, language, and behavior. And I think it's really powerful. So when you have an idea, give it shape. Go to the ignition lab, play around with it, toss it around, give it meaning. And then once you give it meaning, share that meaning, and push that meaning, and it has a snowball effect. It's very, very powerful work. So I would encourage you to take a symbol, a thought, a word, and give it the weight that it deserves.
Any other advice?
I would just say, echo that, keep going, and listen to your heart, and don't be a lawyer. You know, lawyers' jobs and thinking cap, I'm sorry, is to see everything that can possibly go wrong. As an advocate, you have to see everything that could possibly go right. When we first started our not-for-profit, our foundation, we started taking students to the south of France for a month of French language, culture, and art immersion. And we actually formed our not-for-profit so we could take underserved children with overserved children on this program. And in the beginning, people told me I was totally crazy. They're teenagers, they're going to drink, they're going to do drugs, they're going to have sex. don't do it. And it's 20 years later, and we've had hundreds and hundreds of graduates from this program that are now doctors, lawyers, Indian chiefs, and we've taken over 60 children from Newark on this program. Same thing, 100% of them have gone on to college. So believe in yourself, believe in your vision. Don't listen to naysayers. It's easier to be a critic. It's harder to be a creator, and create your own destiny.
Okay, we have time for a couple questions from the audience. There are mics up front here. So do folks have questions that they want to ask any of the panelists? Come on down.
Don't get up all at once, please.
You guys are the most important people here to us. Even though we have esteemed panelists, it really is you guys for us, so please don't be shy. Or be shy, but come down anyway.
I have a question.
Yeah.
And this is maybe a little bit unfair because I'm just all the panelists, but I'm a graduate student actually in the School of Design. I am curious what Pratt is doing to address activism in as an institution, because I think this is the first, in the past 2.5 years or so, maybe one of the first forums that I've seen that is really addressing this issue. We've had a few student groups who are trying to address it, but really as an institution, I haven't really gotten a lot of information from Pratt about what we can do to be more involved. Mm-hmm. And I'm just curious, like, what they feel like their role is, especially since I went to undergraduate at art college, a different art college, and they've been very active and vocal about how to get their students involved.
So I love that question, so thank you, right? Our previous president, Tom Schutte, looked around. He said, we are not keeping up with the needs, not addressing social justice. We don't reflect our community. And he brought in several specialists and consultants, and they created a diversity strategic plan for the entire institute. The diversity strategic plan is now midway in being conceptualized and implemented. Since that, we now have a Center for Equity and Inclusion, the first time ever at Pratt. We have a social justice major. We have a performance and social justice master's program. We have updated all our policies in the policy portal to make sure that we address human rights discrimination concern. We've redone our Title IX structure. And I'm the first assistant vice president ever hired. We've never had an assistant vice president, but the point was to bring somebody that was going to have oversight over student engagement when it comes to social justice, diversity, and inclusion. The other thing was, where are our resources? So the next step in the strategic plan will be to give more resources for scholarship so that we do reflect. 40 of our faculty are now being trained in social justice and diversity and inclusion issues. Provost put money towards that. And there's going to be at least 2 more positions to address those issues. One is a chief diversity officer. They've just articulated the job description. And another one will be in human resources, revamping the needs of the staff so that we can attend to being a real global voice when it comes to creating change. So thank you for that question. And come and talk to me if you have a good idea.
Any other questions?
Okay, so I'm in the main building, room 008. I really do have an open door policy. I do want to hear your ideas. Orville's here to attest, as a student leader when I first met him, that I get the very best ideas from the students. And so we just created a calendar for Heritage Months and Celebration Days. We really want to be able to have everybody be seen, celebrated, and heard. And I'm not just talking, I've been doing this for about 30 years.
Great.
Come visit, 008 Main Building.
Any last questions before we conclude?
Okay, thank you for moderating. I would be remiss if I did not mention Deborah at the CCPD. So everyone, a big round. She was so open. So thank you. Thank you to our panelists. It was amazing, inspiring, and enlightening. Thank you. Thank you guys for coming on this beautiful evening today. I hope it was inspiring, and I hope to see you guys next Thursday. I will be there. They will not be there. They're welcome to be there, but I will be there with Jacob Gordon and Alex Krug, so I hope to see you guys there too. And I think that's it. Have a good night.